Good afternoon to you all. My name is Patrick Lawrence. As a member of the Parish Pastoral Council in Longford, it is my privilege to welcome you to St. Mel's Cathedral for the ordination of Father Paul Connell as Bishop of our Diocese of Ardagh and Clonmacnoise. Welcome also to the representatives of all 41 parishes in the diocese, the religious sisters of the diocese, the representatives of the municipal councils, the priests of the Diocese of Meath, the members of the 1982 Maynooth ordination class, the priests of Ardagh and Clonmacnoise, members of the staff of St. Patrick's College, Maynooth, and St. Finian's College, Mullingar. We warmly welcome the representatives of the other Christian denominations and the representatives of the many religious organizations and agencies who work in our diocese. We welcome the committee members and groups who worked in preparation for the Episcopal ordination and all who are watching this ceremony and live stream. A very special welcome to the family of Bishop-elect Paul, in particular his brother and his sisters, his nephews, niece, and his wider family and friends who are with us today. Cead míle fáilte. As we are shortly going to begin, we ask you to make sure you've turned off your mobile phones. Thank you. There are 5 exit doors, 3 at the back of the cathedral, and 1 off to the right aisle, and 1 off to the left. There are tiles on the side porches near the main door. The cathedral ushers will guide you to receive Holy Communion. Please, wait until you're invited to come forward. For those who need to receive a low glutton host, you may approach Bishop Paul at Communion. Shortly, we will have the procession of banners, 1 for each of the 41 parishes, the reminders of the many places we have come from to be here today. Please remain seated for this procession. Thank you.
Dia is Marihiv Guler. We are gathered for the solemn Episcopal ordination of Father Paul Connell as Bishop of Ardagh and Clonmacnoise. In the 5th century, St. Mel was appointed the first Bishop of the Diocese of Ardagh by St. Patrick. Today, Paul Connell takes his place in a long line of leadership that has included Bishop Cullum and Archbishop Francis, who join us today. On approaching St. Mel's Cathedral, your first sight is that of the 6 iconic pillars of the portico. Above this is a sculpture depicting the installation of St. Mel's. This tableau depicts St. Mel at the center with St. Patrick and his brothers St. Melchew, St. Munus, and St. Rioch, along with St. Bridget and others. Above this tableau, there are 3 statues. In the center, the Sacred Heart, flanked on either side by St. Mel with Crozier and St. Kieran of Clonmacnoise, the twin patrons of our diocese. We have come here today from the 41 parishes of our diocese, journeying from 7 counties, from the meadows of St. Kieran's famed Clonmacnoise, County Offaly, and the shores of Loch Gill in County Sligo, from along the banks of the River Shannon in County Cavan, through lovely Leitrim, Roscommon, Westmeath, and Longford, which is the home of St. Mel. You are heartily welcome here today as we begin a new chapter in the history of our diocese. We come together as a community of faith to celebrate the presence of Christ, the risen Lord among us. We come not as mere spectators, but as participants to pray with and for Paul Connell as he is ordained our leader in faith. Let us now stand and joyfully join in the singing of our first entrance hymn, All Creatures of Our God and King.
Thank you. In anya menachar, agus in vic, agus in spirit nev, amen. Peace be with you. What a wonderful way to gather, by singing with all creation the praises of the Lord. Laudato si, O Signore. These days, of course, we have such beautiful weather, and certainly the sun and the heat, praise the Lord. Maybe evening, the lightning and clouds will praise the Lord too. But we gather here this afternoon to certainly praise the Lord, for we are here to celebrate and to pray with Father Paul, who becomes the new Bishop of Ardagh and Clonmacnois. And we gather here as the people of God. We are his people, the sheep of his flock. And it's great to see so many representatives from the parishes, from the diocese of Ardagh and Clonmacnois, and also of Meath. Many of Father Paul's classmates are here. His family members, of course, and you're especially welcome. I'm delighted to be joined here by the co-consecrators, Archbishop Francis and Bishop Tuam, and also by His Excellency, the Papal Nuncio, and Cardinal Sean Brady, and my brother bishops. And isn't it wonderful to see so many priests here today? This weekend, we've been praying especially for priests. And we thank you and celebrate with those of you who are marking significant anniversaries of priesthood at this time of the year. We are indeed his people, the sheep of his flock. Just this morning, I had an opportunity to go out to Ardagh, to the old church of St. Mel. And it really struck me how the faith in these parts is so deep, going way back to the time when my saintly predecessor, St. Patrick, bestowed on St. Mel responsibility to care for the flock in these parts. And Father Paul, we are hoping and praying that you will have all the graces you need to do so in the future. Welcome to our brothers and sisters from other Christian traditions and other faiths who are with us too. My dear brothers and sisters, to prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries, let us call to mind our sins. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Kyrie eleison. Kyrie eleison. Christe eleison.
Christe eleison. Kyrie eleison.
Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Gloria.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, who out of the abundance of your untold grace alone choose to set your servant and priest Paul over your church of Ardagh and Clonmacnoise this day, grant that he may carry out worthily the office of bishop, and under your governance in all things, he may direct by word and example the people entrusted to his care. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Exodus. From Rephidim, the Israelites set out again. And when they reached the wilderness of Sinai, there in the wilderness they pitched their camp. There facing the mountain, Israel pitched camp. Moses then went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, "Say this to the house of Jacob. Declare this to the sons of Israel. You yourselves have seen what I did with the Egyptians, how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. From this you know that now, if you obey my voice and hold fast to my covenant, you of all the nations shall be my very own, for all the earth is mine. I will count you a kingdom of priests, a consecrated nation." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Go within his gates and bless his name. Come before thanks to him and bless him.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. We were still helpless when at his appointed moment, Christ died for sinful men. It is not easy to die, even for a good man. Though, of course, for someone really worthy, a man might be prepared to die. But what proves that God loves us is that Christ died for us while we were still sinners. Having died to make us righteous, is it likely that he would now fail to save us from God's anger? When we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, we were still enemies. Now that we have been reconciled, surely we may count on being saved by the life of his Son. Not merely because we have been reconciled, but because we are filled with joyful trust in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have already gained our reconciliation. This is the word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. When Jesus saw the crowds, he felt sorry for them because they were harassed and dejected, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is rich, but the laborers are few. So ask the Lord of the harvest to send laborers to his harvest." He summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits, with power to cast them out and to cure all kinds of diseases and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, the one who was to betray him. These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them as follows. Do not turn your steps to pagan territory, and do not enter any Samaritan town. Go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And as you go, proclaim that the kingdom of heaven is close at hand. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out devils. You receive without charge, give without charge. The Gospel of the Lord.
We now prepare for the rite of ordination. For generations, the core of this ceremony has been the laying on of hands, the prayer of consecration, and the anointing with chrism. This will be followed by the presentation of the book of the Gospels and the investiture with the symbols of the office of bishop. Before all this, Father Paul will be called forward by Father Tom Healy, diocesan administrator, who will request that Father Paul be ordained for service as bishop. The letter of mandate from Pope Francis will be read, to which we are invited to respond, thanks be to God. Father Michael McGrath will preach today's homily. Let us stand and sing, Veni Creator Spiritus.
Thank you. Most Reverend Father, the Church of Ardagh and Clonmacnoise asks you to ordain this priest, Paul Connell, for service as bishop.
Have you a mandate from the Holy See?
We have.
Let it be read.
Francis, Bishop, servant of the servants of God. To our beloved son, Paul Connell, of the clergy of the Diocese of Meath, and heretofore Chancellor and Rector of the Parish of Multifarnham, now nominated Bishop of Ardagh and Clonmacnoise, greetings and all blessings. United in love, as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, he is the vine, we his branches, nor can we have life without him. As Saint Augustine says, let us show to all our brethren that care and concern which we take as a model and which we rejoice in when we are teaching them. Sustained, therefore, by this rule of our prayer, our faith and our way of life, we turn our attention with fatherly affection to the spiritual needs of the ecclesial community of Ardagh and Clonmacnoise, which, left vacant by the translation of its late bishop, our venerable brother Francis Duffy, to the Archdiocese of Tuam, awaits a new pastor of its diocesan life. Our thoughts then have turned to you, beloved son, as one fitted by your human and priestly achievements to undertake these serious responsibilities. Therefore, having consulted the dicastery for bishops and by our apostolic authority, we hereby appoint you Bishop of Ardagh and Clonmacnoise, granting you your due rights and laying on you the corresponding obligations. You may receive ordination anywhere outside the city of Rome, observing liturgical norms from any Catholic bishop, you having previously made profession of faith and sworn faithfulness to ourselves and to our successors in accordance with the sacred canons. It is our wish that you inform the clergy and people of that diocese of this decree, by which we urge them from the bottom of our heart to receive you enthusiastically as their father, teacher, and guardian. May God adorn you, beloved son, with the virtues becoming the apostolic service and the charity of the gospel, so that the flock committed to your care and formed by your leadership may follow Christ by loving him as he loved them. May they accept with joy the things necessary for salvation and show them forth by example in the decorum of their lives. Given at Rome at the Lateran on the 5th of April of the year of our Lord, 2023, in the 11th year of our pontificate. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
Today, St. Mel's Cathedral welcomes her diocesan family and many who have come from Mullingar and all around the Diocese of Meath, and indeed from all over the country and beyond, to celebrate this special day in the life of Father Paul Connell and all of us, the people of God in the Diocese of Ardagh and Clonmacnoise. Paul, today as the twin spires of the Cathedral of Christ the King diminish in your rearview mirror, we want to assure you of 100,000 welcomes to this sacred place. Cade Mila Falcha. We hope you will grow to be happy here in your new home. You will notice on the chair, the cathedra, from where you'll teach and lead, the words from John's Gospel, uttered first to Peter in a moment of second calling, "Feed my sheep." Today, through the laying on of hands and a gesture of being called again by the same Lord, hear those words, "Feed my sheep." Just as he, so you now be a shepherd. The gospel text that the church gives us on this 11th Sunday in ordinary time reminds us that Jesus' ministry begins in his heart, or more literally, in his guts. His message is of compassion. The word used for compassion literally means to be moved in the bowels. It is a physical feeling with, suffering with the other. As the compassion of God himself, Jesus' destiny will ultimately be the cross. No greater love than this. Echoes here of the day of your priestly ordination, when the rite challenged you to model your life on the mystery of the Lord's cross. That is essentially the call to compassion. That gravity pulling downward to the one who is most in need. Matthew's Jesus feels sorry for the lost, the harassed and the dejected. Much more than mere pity, his asking for laborers for the harvest is a cry from his heart of compassion that others in his footsteps might be his compassionate presence and feed the sheep. All the lost and wounded in our divided world. The dejection of which the gospel speaks is more accurately a sense of being torn asunder, divided. What divides us is demonic. We demonize the one on the other side of the divide. The church is not immune here. There are many lines that divide us, lines of ideology, lines of gender and gender identity, lines of race, lines dividing rich from poor, and many others, lines everywhere. Compassion seeks to dissolve the lines and call us back to our common humanity, the reality of who we are in the flesh that God saw as good enough to become in Jesus. Summoned by name, the 12 are sent to the ones Jesus noticed as harassed and dejected. The ones like sheep without a shepherd, the lost sheep. These 12 would now be living signs of his compassion for the whole of Israel, all her 12 tribes. And his message is what they'll bring with them. The kingdom of heaven is close at hand. Remember, this is how Jesus emerged from the desert to begin his public ministry. Matthew tells us he began his preaching with the message, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand." Earlier, this had been the exact same message of John the Baptist. There is continuity then between John, Jesus, and now the 12. The kingdom of heaven is close at hand. Strange though the apostles' charge, doesn't include the challenge of repentance. Maybe it is presumed. Repentance is much more than giving up our old sins. The gospel word for it is metanoia, from the Greek meta, beyond, and nous, mind. The challenge of metanoia, which is often translated as conversion, is really to think beyond, change the mind to think big. The idea of the kingdom requires some big thinking and big living. Kingdom thinking is to think outside the box, beyond. It is to think in line with the Beatitudes, to see beyond the apparent curse and see blessing, to live poverty in spirit and in the knowledge of the blessed possession of heaven, to mourn in assured comfort, to hunger and thirst and yet have whetted appetite for justice satisfied, to live and experience mercy, to live purity of heart and see God, to live peace in the midst of trial. The preaching of the kingdom promises happiness in unexpected places. Repentance might be simply to change the direction in which we look for happiness, the kingdom. As you join in succession now to the apostles, help us to think big, big enough to comprehend the reality of God's reign among us, and help us to walk and work together for the sake of the message and its credibility, if for no other reason. Chances are that if Simon the Zealot had met Matthew the tax collector anywhere else than in the company of Jesus, he would have stuck a dagger in him. It is a tremendous truth that people who don't exactly pull, as they say, can learn to love each other when they both love Jesus Christ. Too often, religion is seen as divisive. It is meant to be, and in the presence of the living Jesus, it was a means of bringing people together. Without Christ, we run the danger of being sundered from each other. Walking together, this is the challenge of synodality, the way we are called to live and preach the kingdom of God today. How God's Spirit is calling us to be church. It's always better when we are together. We have begun walking that challenging path here in Ardagh and Clonmacnois. For a number of years, we have tiptoed along the synodal pathway, praying in our assembly prayer that we would reflect the face of the Good Shepherd, to bring back the stray, look for the lost, and bandage the wounded of our world. That we would build a church of solidarity with the haunted faces of refugees, the wounded of war, and the voiceless victims of injustice in every land. And that we would be united as a family of lay and religious, young and old, women and men, with you, our Bishop, to guide us. And that together, we would all reflect God the Father's dream of a church as a mother hen who gathers all under the wings of shelter and protection. Identifying our pastoral priorities going forward as outreach to young families, young people, and formation of people for mission, we are like the 12 of today's gospel, trying to model our lives on Jesus, and so like him to reach outward, to heal, to raise, to cleanse, and to cast out, heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those of unclean spirit, cast out demons. Jesus gave authority to the 12 and empowered them, and in his strength they went out. And so do we. Because just as there is a line of continuity from John the Baptist to Jesus, to the 12, the task belongs to all of us today, with you, Paul, walking with us as fellow Christian and leading us as bishop. That is what we're about. This is what our baptism is about. This is what the church is about, what the Diocese of Ardagh and Clonmacnoise is about. As it was for Finian and the 12 apostles of Ireland who studied under him, and among them, St. Kieran of Clonmacnoise. And as it was for St. Mel and his church at Ardagh, ours still is the task of bearing witness to our faith by everything we say and do, so enabling the reign of God break into our broken world today. In being a leaven in the world by our witness, we do bring healing. We do bring life. We do cast out demons, becoming midwives to the awesome mystery of God's reign. Paul, you are most welcome among us as pastor. Feed us and lead us into friendship with Jesus, and keep us reminded that ultimately it is his work we're all about, his kingdom, and that in the end it all depends on him and on his grace working in all of us, in our homes, our schools, our parishes, all of us working and walking together. Lead us to see the big picture, the kingdom of God among us and beyond us. And though the task is enormous and though the laborers are indeed few, we remain grounded but open, because in the end it is all down to his grace, as the Romero prayer suggests. It helps now and then to step back and take a long view. The kingdom is not only beyond our efforts, it is beyond our vision. We accomplish in our lifetime only a fraction of the magnificent enterprise that is God's work. Nothing we do is complete, which is another way of saying that the kingdom always lies beyond us. No statement says all that could be said. No prayer expresses our faith fully. No confession brings perfection. No pastoral visit brings wholeness. No program accomplishes the church's mission. No set of goals and objectives includes everything. This is what we're about. We plant the seeds that one day will grow. We water the seeds already planted, knowing that they hold future promise. We lay foundations that will need further development. We provide yeast that provides effects far beyond our capabilities. We cannot do everything. And there's a sense of liberation in realizing this, because it enables us to do something, and to do it very well. It may be incomplete, but it is a beginning, a step along the way, an opportunity for the Lord's grace to enter and do the rest. We may never see the end results, but that is the difference between the master builder and the worker. We are workers, not master builders, ministers, not messiahs. We are prophets of a future not our own. Paul, we promise to work with you. Help each one of us find our voice in the chorus that continues to sing, "The kingdom of heaven is close at hand."
An age-old custom of the fathers decrees that a bishop-elect is to be questioned before his people on his resolve to uphold the faith and to discharge his duties faithfully. My brother, are you resolved by the grace of the Holy Spirit to discharge to the end of your life the office the apostles entrusted to us, which we now pass on to you by the laying on of the hands?
I am.
Are you resolved to be faithful and constant in proclaiming the gospel of Christ?
I am.
Are you resolved to maintain the deposit of faith entire and incorrupt, as handed down by the apostles and professed by the church everywhere and at all times?
I am.
Are you resolved to build up the church as the body of Christ and to remain united to it within the order of bishops under the authority of the successor of the apostle Peter?
I am.
Are you resolved to be faithful to your obedience to the successor of the apostle Peter?
I am.
Are you resolved, as a devoted father, to sustain the people of God and to guide them in the way of salvation in cooperation with the presbyters and deacons who share your ministry?
I am.
Are you resolved to show kindness and compassion in the name of the Lord to the poor and to strangers and to all who are in need?
I am.
Are you resolved, as a good shepherd, to seek out the sheep who stray and to gather them into the fold of the Lord?
I am.
Are you resolved to pray for the people of God without ceasing, and to carry out the duties of one who has the fullness of the priesthood, so as to offer no grounds for reproach?
I am, with the help of God.
May God, who has begun the good work in you, bring it to fulfillment. My dear people, let us stand and let us pray that Almighty God in his goodness will pour out his grace upon this man whom he has chosen to provide for the needs of the church. Anoint your servant with the fullness of
priestly grace, and bless him with spiritual power in all its richness. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father of mercies and God of all consolation, you dwell in heaven, yet look with compassion on all that is humble. You know all things before they come to be. By your gracious word, you have established the plan of your church. From the beginning, you chose the descendants of Abraham to be your holy nation. You established rulers and priests, and you did not leave your sanctuary without ministers to serve you. From the creation of the world, you have been pleased to be glorified by those whom you have chosen. So now, pour upon this chosen one that power which is from you, the governing spirit whom you gave to your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, the spirit given by him to the holy apostles, who founded the church in every place to be your temple for the unceasing glory and praise of your name. Father, you know all our hearts. You have chosen your servant for the office of bishop. May he be a shepherd to your holy flock and a high priest blameless in your sight, ministering to you night and day. May he always gain the blessing of your favor and offer the gifts of your holy church. Through the Spirit, who gives the grace of high priesthood, grant him the power to forgive sins as you have commanded, to assign ministries as you have decreed, and to loose every bond by the authority which you gave to your apostles. May he be pleasing to you by his gentleness and purity of heart, presenting a fragrant offering to you through Jesus Christ, your Son, through whom glory and power and honor are yours, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, now and forever. Amen. Amen. God has brought you to share the high priesthood of Christ. May he pour out on you the oil of mystical anointing and enrich you with spiritual blessings. Receive the gospel and preach the word of God with unfailing patience and sound teaching. Take this ring, the seal of your fidelity. With faith and love, protect the bride of God, his holy church. Take this staff as a sign of your pastoral office. Keep watch over the whole flock in which the Holy Spirit has appointed you to shepherd the Church of God.
Oh,
Bishop Paul, we congratulate you and warmly welcome you as our new bishop. We invite you to meet representatives of the other Christian denominations, parish volunteers, catechists, pastoral workers, and diocesan assembly committee members who are from the four deaneries. Children and their teachers due for confirmation, and a priest and religious sister will also greet you on behalf of the parishioners of our diocese.
My brothers and sisters, let us stand and together join in professing our faith in the Creed.
Oh.
brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. We offer you the sacrifice of praise, O Lord, for the deepening of our service of you, so that what you have conferred on us, unworthy as we are, you may graciously bring to fulfillment through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up our hearts.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by the anointing of the Holy Spirit, you made your only begotten Son, High Priest of the new and eternal covenant, and by your wondrous design were pleased to decree that his one priesthood should continue in the Church. For Christ not only adorns with a royal priesthood the people he has made his own, but with a brother's kindness he also chooses men to become sharers in his sacred ministry through the laying on of hands. They are to renew in his name the sacrifice of human redemption, to set before your children the paschal banquet, to lead your holy people in charity, to nourish them with the word and strengthen them with the sacraments. As they give up their lives for you and for the salvation of their brothers and sisters, they strive to be conformed to the image of Christ himself and offer you a constant witness of faith and love. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks, as in exaltation we acclaim. Therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world. Together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and me, your unworthy servant, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith.
Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here, whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them, we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true.
In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, and all your saints, we ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things, we may be defended by your protecting help.
Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we make to you. Also for me, your unworthy servant, whom you have pleased to raise to the order of bishops, and in your mercy keep safe your gifts in me, so that what I have received by divine commission I may fulfill by divine assistance. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty, from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them, as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and blessing.
Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace.
To us also, your servants, who though sinners hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Mel, Chiron, Finian, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord.
Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
an ish guimish conanahar fivar avun or slani harduing a yenov. Nahar atarnia, gane for danum, gadaga the riak, nenta the heller and dadov, maranator arna, orner oinle hul tur doing in you, agus mat doing or viaka, marawahami gar vekuna fein, agus nalik shinigahu, agser shin oon. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, for you live forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. With let us offer a gesture of peace to one another. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Complete within us, O Lord, we pray, the healing work of your mercy, and graciously perfect and sustain us, so that in all things we may please you, through Christ our Lord.
Thank you.
As we come to the end of this ceremony, it's my very pleasant task to express my deep appreciation to all of you who are present here, and also to those of you who join us by webcam. A special welcome to those joining us from abroad, and in particular those of you in the United States, especially in the parishes of All Saints and St. Gabriel's in Florida and St. Gregory the Great in San Diego. I want to begin by thanking the new papal nuncio, His Excellency Archbishop Luis Mariano Montemayor, for his presence here today. We warmly welcome him and wish him well as he takes up his new position here in Ireland as the personal representative of our Holy Father, Pope Francis. I want to thank sincerely Archbishop Eamon Martin for being Principal Consecrator, and also the two co-consecrators, Archbishop Francis Duffy, the former bishop of this diocese, and the Bishop of Meath, Tom Deenihan. I'm also very grateful for the presence and support of all the bishops who have come here today, and also the support of my two chaplains, my good friends, Monsignor Joseph McGuinness and Father Joseph Gallagher. My grateful thanks to Father Michael McGrath for his eloquent and insightful homily today. I extend a very warm welcome and thanks to the Church of Ireland Bishop, Ferran Glenfield, and to the representatives of other Christian traditions for their presence with us and for their prayers and good wishes. I know that everyone here was welcomed at the beginning of our ceremony, and I thank you all for your very supportive presence here today. To the people of the diocese, I want to express my deep gratitude for the very warm welcome you have given me, and I'm looking forward to meeting and working with you across the diocese in the coming years. This ceremony, and indeed the hospitality that will follow in St. Mel's College, would not have been possible without the superb organization that has been put into place by a very large network of volunteers. I am very grateful to every single one of you. Thank you so much to those who assisted in any way with parking, stewarding, catering, and printing, and to the ICA especially for the floral arrangements which you will enjoy later. I would like to express my deep gratitude to Fintan Farrelly, the Cathedral Choir and soloists, for the wonderful music which adorned our liturgy today and which has lifted up our hearts and our spirits. I also deeply appreciate the work of planning and preparation by Father Thurlock Baxter, Master of Ceremonies, and his assistants, and by Father James McKiernan, the priests of the cathedral and their parish team. I would like especially to thank the Board of Management of St. Mel's College, the Principal Mr. Manicky Flanagan and his staff for their hospitality and vital contribution to today's ceremony. I know that all of you from the diocese would particularly want me to thank on your behalf Archbishop Francis Duffy for his 10 years ministering among you as your bishop. There was very genuine regret and sorrow when the news came that he was moving to Tuam as its new archbishop. That says a great deal about his commitment and energy and the very pastoral style of his leadership here among you. Thank you, Archbishop Francis. Of course, as we stand in this beautiful cathedral, reborn from the ashes, we are all immensely grateful to the team of people responsible for its restoration. Which of us, though, can forget seeing Bishop Colm O'Reilly on the television news on Christmas Day 2009, assuring the people of the diocese that despite the daunting prospect that was ahead, their cathedral would be rebuilt, And indeed it was, as we all witness today. As important as that was, it was just one achievement of many during the ministry of Bishop Colum in this diocese for over 30 years. I'm acutely aware of how he is held in the highest esteem and affection by the people of the diocese. We're all delighted to see him here today, and I hope to benefit from his invaluable insight and advice for many years to come. Father Tom Healy tells me he's a very happy man today. I wonder why. I know he's looking forward to a quieter life, for the moment anyway. We all know of the vital role he played in coordinating the restoration of this cathedral. But we must also thank him most sincerely for the manner in which he has led the diocese as its administrator since the departure of Archbishop Duffy. He has not spared his talents or his time in the role, and I know that his work has been deeply appreciated by all of you here in the diocese. Thank you, Father Tom. We believe that God calls each of us, but he does not provide us with an outline of our lives, an outline of what will happen to us. We do not know as we go through life what faces us, what manner of life we will have, what joys or sorrows, what crosses and pain may come our way. We cannot predict our tomorrow. We all have to make that leap of faith and trust in God, that he loves and cares for each of us, and that he knows what is best for us. There are moments in all of our lives when everything suddenly changes. Sometimes we can plan for that moment, but at other times it comes like a bolt from the blue. My appointment by Pope Francis as Bishop of Ardagh and Clonmacnoise was such a moment. It was for me completely unexpected. And I was faced with a decision that, to say the least, was not easy. I knew that saying yes as I did would change everything. But I did so because in the end I believe that what makes my life authentic is that I continue to have that same faith and trust in God that set me out on the path of priesthood all those years ago. And while I have met difficulties and challenges along the way, and while I also have a much better appreciation of how weak a vessel of clay I am, I can honestly say that I've never had any regrets about my decision to say yes to priesthood. Placing our faith and trust in God involves, above all, listening to what he is asking of us. We do this by listening to his word, but also by listening to the church, as well as the world around us. One way in particular that he does speak to us is in and through the people that surround us, our families, neighbors, friends, acquaintances, those whom we live with, meet with, and work with. The synodal process inaugurated by Pope Francis gives us an opportunity to become a listening church. In his words, it enables us to break out of our routine in order to stop and listen. Firstly, to the Spirit in adoration and prayer, and then to our brothers and sisters, their hopes, the crisis of faith around the world, the need for renewed pastoral life. Today we have listened to the words of the gospel. The harvest is rich, but the laborers are few. What are they saying to us? We know the harvest is rich, but certainly at this time very difficult. As a church, we live in very interesting times, facing many challenges. Our society is in danger, of losing the sense of the sacred, above all the truth that we come from God and that someday we will return to God. And so its moral compass is imperiled with an increasing stress on the rights of the individual to the detriment of society as a whole. Faith and practice, too, are affected when people lose touch with community worship. And so as we look around, we see difficulties for the church on all sides. The temptation to despair is great, but none of this is new. 60 years ago, when Pope Paul VI opened the second session of the Second Vatican Council on the 29th of September 1963, he spoke about the church building a bridge to the contemporary world. And he confessed he was tempted. He was tempted to be frightened and saddened, to condemn and defend in the face of the Iron Curtain of communism, the spread of atheism, the emptiness and despair in so many human hearts. He refused to despair, however. Not now, he said, while love was flooding the heart of the church, the servant of mankind. And so we too must have courage, because in the midst of our difficulty, God is speaking to us. The harvest is rich, but the laborers are few. For too long we have seen the laborers as priests and religious. Yes, we need priests and religious, and we need now more than ever to pray for vocations and encourage people, young and older, to accept the invitation that Christ is extending to them. I want to acknowledge on your behalf the incredible commitment and service of our priests. This diocese has been so blessed with their ministry. We are, however, an aging priesthood, and the model of church we have been living with will not survive what is happening now. And so we together, as a listening church, must try to understand and discern that somehow in the midst of this necessary change, that God is speaking to us. How shall we change our world? We shall not. God will do it, or it will not happen. But he will not do it without us, through men and women whose dynamism for change is not theirs alone, but the power and work of God. God has chosen each of us. He is the source of our life in Christ Jesus. In this time of change, we, the laity and the clergy of this diocese, guided by the spirit of holiness, openness, and truth, have to discern the future of our church. This is our responsibility as disciples of Christ, listening to each other and also those beyond our comfort zone. Archbishop Dermot Farrell, in a recent homily on the feast of St. Kevin, quoted the words of Cardinal Aveline of Marseille for the new Archbishop of Lille. The cardinal said, "The mission of the church is not to be a religion which succeeds according to the world's criteria for success, those of control and efficiency. No, the mission of the church is humbly to cooperate with the Holy Spirit in order to be at the service of that love with which God loves the world. Without counting the cost, give of yourself to this people who await you, this people whom God has entrusted to you, and to whom you have been entrusted by God. I pray that together you may live the wonderful adventure of being disciples of Christ, the wonderful adventure of the mission of the church." As you can imagine, these words have particular resonance for me today. I can only hope that with God's help, I can repay the trust that all of you are placing in me. Please continue to pray for me as I will pray every day for you, the people, priests, and religious of the Diocese of Ardagh and Clonmacnoise. Together, may we share what Cardinal Avelin describes as the wonderful adventure of being disciples of Christ, the wonderful adventure of the mission of the Church. May God bless us all. And let us pray. O God, who care for your people with gentleness and rule them in love, endow with the spirit of wisdom those to whom you have handed on authority to govern, that from the flourishing of a holy flock may come eternal joy for its shepherds. Amen. As in your majestic power, you allot the number of our days and the measure of our years. Look favorably upon our humble service and confer on our time the abundance of your peace. Amen. Give a happy outcome to the tasks that through your grace you have laid upon me, whom you have raised to the rank of bishop. Make me pleasing to you in the fulfillment of my duties, and so guide the hearts of people and pastor, that the obedience of the flock may never fail the shepherd, nor the care of the shepherd be lacking for the flock. Amen. And may Almighty God bless you all who are gathered here, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Amen.